Okay.
Manish, you can actually just tell him.
Manish? Rajesh, I'm taking a photo and sending it to you, okay? Manish can tell him okay. Because this is very brief what they have given.
Yeah, so they have now, I was muted, so I couldn't speak up till now. Now also that I am
Rajesh, I see your WhatsApp. Okay.
I'll send you WhatsApp.
Okay.
No, I'm sending you a message here. I can send you a message also.
Should we send you the AIOS background? Or is it too?
I think it's all right. It's all right.
If you can give me your email address, I will just send it in a second.
Yeah.
What is your email address? Dr. Rita,
I'm just sending the details to Dr. Rajesh Sinha.
Yeah. You have my email ID?
It's coming to you on chat. It will come on your this app only.
Okay.
So, ma'am, we are going live?
Yes.
Okay. No, just wait for a minute.
Just one second.
Let him...
Can you quickly send me the email? It's 5:02, Rajesh. Let's leave it. I think we should go live.
Yeah, I think we can have it on this background only. Forget the background.
Yeah, okay.
Only I just wanted to know the system for getting the questions. Because up till now in the other CMEs, I have been receiving the questions on chat and it worked well. Now they have a different app. I have it opened here. So somebody can send a question. So at least I know that how the questions are coming.
Please send Nishant. Please send the link to.
No, link is already there. It's already open. I have the thing here. But there are no questions here.
There will be no problem. You will be able. What is the topic of the title of the talk?
Then we can start. We can start that.
Non-IOP. Non-IOP risk factors in glaucoma.
Non-IOP risk factors. Okay. I think now we can go live if you want and. I will introduce so you can come to me and then we'll go live.
Mubin. Thoda live ban kar sakta hai.
Just one second.
Yeah.
Where is the email for the where is the CV?
You don't really need to say much, Namrata. I think we can start off without very formal introductions. Well, I'm a private practitioner. I've been in practice for the last 40 years. I'm in a small place in Maharashtra.
No. I
that should be good.
No, I've got it. No, that should not be good. Okay, I've got it here. So now you can make it live.
उसको अनम्यूट करना है
आरआई फ्रॉम मुंबई विद ऑलमोस्ट 3 डिकेड्स ऑफ मैग्निफिसेंट कैरियर बिहाइंड हर डॉक्टर हीवानकर हेड्स द ग्लूकोमा डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ लक्ष्मी आई इंस्टीट्यूट एंड हेड्स द लक्ष्मी कॉलेज ऑफ ऑप्टोमेट्री. And she's been bestowed by Dr. Darstoor's gold medal during her post-graduation tenure and Rao Bahadur Maniyar Prize in Dermatology in her graduation and the Shiv Prasad Hardia Prize at the All India Ophthalmological Society. She has, to her credit, at International and National Ophthalmic Fests on Glaucoma, numerous presentations as a speaker and as a contributor, including the Southeast Asia Glaucoma Interest Group and World Glaucoma Congress. And she was one of the first ophthalmologists to start using selective laser trabeculoplasty. And she's also involved in various drug trials for glaucoma, both at the international and the... And Sina, who's the treasurer of All India Ophthalmological Society, and he's going to be introducing to you the panelist of the day today, Dr. Manisha.
Good evening. I welcome you all in this webinar. It's a wonderful topic, and we have Dr. Manisha as a panelist, who is a senior consultant at Leelavati Hospital and director at Foresight Eye Center, and has a glaucoma clinic in Mumbai. He has an overall experience of 22 years. He is an active member of Glaucoma Society of India, has been faculty at annual conferences since 2001. He has been actively involved in various conferences, both internationally and nationally, and has many publications in peer-reviewed journals. So I would like to welcome Dr. Manisha. Welcome, Dr. Manisha.
And now over to Dr. Rita for her presentation.
Obviously, every one of you must be thinking, there is glaucoma and there is intraocular pressure, and why am I talking about things like non-IOP risk factors? But there is a reason to it all. Why are we thinking of this today? Is because we all do know that elevated intraocular pressure means glaucoma, but that is actually an old thinking. There is actually a need now to identify the real pathology. Is there something that is still eluding us? Do we already know things that we can change? And that is what we're going to look at today. So IOP is a relatively big risk factor in glaucoma. That is very well understood. But look at this slide now. It tells you that you can have a normal IOP with no glaucoma in the normal population, and you can have normal IOP in normal tension glaucoma where there is glaucoma. Similarly, you can have no glaucoma with high intraocular pressures as an ocular hypertension, and you can have glaucoma present in open-angle glaucoma with high intraocular pressures. We've all seen patients well on their target continuing to progress. Why does this happen? Is our target wrong? Are the patients not compliant enough? Are there other factors? And if so, how do we identify them? Obviously, any patient who is progressing needs further attention. Look into compliance in detail, because many times when they come to you, they have this white coat syndrome and they have their drops well on place, but otherwise they don't use their medications as has been prescribed. And so though when you see them, the pressure is on target, the pressure is really not on target, and they're continuing to progress. Look for intraocular pressure fluctuations, because you're only seeing a very minuscule amount of the pressure, whereas the same intraocular pressure deals with that eye for 24 hours, and you are just taking a few seconds to measure this pressure. Look at the cause for fluctuations. And there are many simple things that you can do. Is there a fluid overload? Could it just be a tight collar? An executive at work goes very formally dressed with a very tight tie, and that could raise his intraocular pressure. Could it be a periodic breath holding, like musicians who use breath holding to play musical instruments? So what do we really need to ask for? We need to ask them history, and history of systemic hypertension is one of the most important things that we need to find out. We also need to find out the current treatment that they're using for the systemic hypertension. Other than that, we need to find out what medications are they taking, especially if they are steroids. They could be systemic, inhaled, topical, or nasal steroids. And all of these can actually elevate the intraocular pressure. Then you've got to think of compromised ocular perfusion. So you have diseases like the Raynaud's, like sleep apnea, syncope, hypotension, acute blood loss with transfusions, which could all give rise to a compromised ocular perfusion. And neurologic symptoms like headache, weakness, dizziness, diplopia, or loss of consciousness. All of these and more can actually lead you to what you need to know. So other than intraocular pressure, is there something else? Yes, and I've just said that we have to look at all these things. So you have to look whether the patient has suffered from a major blood loss, as this patient has had long periods of ocular ischemia. And there are a number of randomized clinical trials which have looked at risk, non-IOP risk factors in glaucoma, which cause progression. So we have the OATS trial, the early manifest glaucoma trial, the advanced glaucoma trial, and the normal tension glaucoma trial. And they have identified many factors: low perfusion pressure, age, central corneal thickness, cup disc ratio, Patton standard deviation on the visual field, presence of pseudo exfoliation, disc hemorrhage, and vasospasm. Now, if you see that age and disc hemorrhage has been marked as red, because those are the things that three trials have found to be in common. But we have to look at other factors that cause glaucoma. So what are these other factors? There are two major things that you have to look for: an autoregulatory dysfunction, which can be because of ocular perfusion pressure, which is not normal, the intraocular pressure, which is not normal. You could be looking for an ocular blood flow, and all this could result also in a perfusion instability, which could be even enhanced by an ischemic insult or by a reperfusion injury. Both of these in turn lead to a retinal ganglion cell, which finally moves on to glaucoma. So vaso-autoregulation, what is that? It helps to meet the body's needs, and it is tailored to meet fluctuating local metabolic demands. So for instance, if you've had your lunch and you had a heavy meal, all the blood supply is then obviously sent towards the digestive system. And the vascular tone maintains appropriate levels of the hydrostatic pressure, avoiding edema. Regulation is mediated by three phenomena. You have the autonomic nervous system, you have the systemic hormones, and you have local autoregulation. Now, there are two types of stimuli for local autoregulation, which are myogenic and metabolic. And these can induce a response from the local vasculature. So the metabolic demand or supply can increase or decrease, which modifies the perceived need for oxygen and nutrients. And that is how you can either get an increase in your blood supply or decrease in your blood supply. Metabolic factors can then alter the vascular tone. What happens when we talk about a myogenic stimulus? Now, as the blood flow increases, the smooth muscle cells of these vessels are stretched. This opens the calcium channels. With an influx of calcium, the muscle contracts. It reduces the lumen of the vessel and reduces the blood flow. This is what happens in a normal individual. However, several studies have shown this autoregulation to be deranged in glaucoma, and this could be due to a dysfunction of the endothelial factors responsible for maintaining the vascular tone. Impaired autoregulation results in altered oxygen being supplied to the ocular tissue. If the oxygen supply is reduced, there would be an ischemic damage. If the oxygen levels are increased, then it could lead to oxidative stress and cell damage. Now you have to know that there is something which is known as a constant ocular perfusion. And what is this constant ocular perfusion dominated by? So there is a definite systemic relation between the systemic hypertension and hypotension. There is a regulation of the vascular blood flow by vascular tone mediators and the intraocular pressure. Changes in any of these can result in a cellular damage, in apoptosis of the retinal ganglion cells, and tissue remodeling, resulting in glaucomatous optic neuropathy. Systemic hypertension, we know, has a positive correlation between intraocular pressure and the systolic pressure. Chronic hypertensives may have microvascular changes and impaired blood flow to the optic nerve head. Ocular blood flow is dependent on the ocular perfusion pressure. Now, what is ocular perfusion pressure? It's very easy to calculate. It's just 2/3 of the mean arterial pressure minus the intraocular pressure. Therefore, when the intraocular pressure increases or the arterial pressure decreases, obviously the ocular perfusion pressure is going to reduce. When the diastolic ocular perfusion pressure goes below 50 millimeters of mercury, this increases the risk of incident or progressive open angle glaucoma up to 5-fold. Patients with nocturnal hypotension are also known to progress. And in these patients, it's very simple. All you need to do is get back to their physician. And if you can change their systemic medications so as to not have this nocturnal hypotension, but at the same time, have a good control of their hypertension, that will help us in maintaining a good ocular perfusion pressure even at night. Now, the reduced ocular perfusion pressure is because of many things. You can have a reduced CSF pressure because of the biomechanical properties. You can have an increased intraocular pressure. You could have a decreased blood flow, all of which could result in a reduced ocular perfusion pressure. All of this leads to a primary insult. Now, in the primary insult, the RGC mitochondria are mildly affected, and therefore the RGCs are now at reduced energy levels. This leads to a secondary insult, and that finally leads to the RGC death. Now, the reduced ocular perfusion can also be because of abnormal neurovascular coupling or abnormal autoregulation. And that in turn also again leads to the RGC death. Let's look at this case. This was a young 35-year-old patient who came with a history of a sudden fall in vision. This patient had a CRVO in one eye with a high intraocular pressure in both the eyes. This patient was treated for a CRVO, but his glaucoma was progressing despite being on maximal medical therapy, and his IOP was in the low teens. So what do you think could have been the cause? He was progressing. I was wondering what to do with this patient, but I just thought that let me look at his ocular blood flow. So we got a carotid Doppler done, and that showed us a plaque of grade 3-4 in the common carotid artery at its bifurcation. There was a thickened intima in the common carotid artery, which was suggestive of atherosclerotic changes. There was a low velocity flow noted in the left vertebral artery, and an ocular color and spectral Doppler suggested an occlusion of the left ophthalmic and the left central retinal artery, causing a left-sided ocular ischemia. And so we knew that was probably the reason why his left glaucoma continued to progress despite being on the correct therapy. Now, reduced ocular perfusion, blood flow velocities, and or altered resistivity index could be a predictor for glaucoma progression. Color Doppler imaging is a good modality for the imaging and the hemodynamic study of the optic nerve vessels. It may help in facilitating the understanding of the pathogenesis of glaucoma. What we may do is probably introduce blood flow measurements into the clinical practice for diagnostic and follow-up glaucoma disease. This could also help in the care of the patients of glaucoma where nothing else works. Patients with migraine have a higher intraocular pressure, and patients with normal tension glaucoma have a higher incidence of migraine. Migraine is vasospastic despite having a neural origin. Vasospasm may be related to endothelium-derived vasoactive factors. Both Raynaud's and migraine are associated with an increased endothelin 1, and so also is normal tension glaucoma. Now, this is a case of a 40-year-old female patient who initially presented for a headache, was diagnosed to have a primary angle closure glaucoma in the right eye and a primary angle closure in the left eye. So she underwent a peripheral iridotomy in both the eyes, and she needed to be on topical anti-glaucoma medications even post her iridotomy. Her episodes of headache lessened, but they did not really subside, but her vision continued to fall. She was developing lens changes. A repeat gonioscopy showed that there were peripheral anterior synechiae in the right eye, but the left eye was very wide open. So I did all her parameters. Her anterior chamber depth seemed to be okay. Her lens thickness seemed to be okay. The IOP was well controlled, but the disc in the right eye continued to worsen. And the perimetry in the left eye was within normal limits. There was a, on the overview in the visual fields, the right eye showed us a progression. Sorry. On a D, we found that there were episodic attacks of headaches with an aura. The attack lasted for 24 to 30 hours. It was always associated with photophobia. Sometimes the attack was aborted with drugs. A diagnosis of migraine was made and she was treated for the same. She's being monitored on a regular basis and it took us 6 months to see her perimetry did not change repeatedly on 3 visual fields. Thereafter, her visual fields have been stable for the last 3 years. The cause for progression was probably migraine. Now, cerebrospinal fluid pressure suddenly gained a lot of importance in the last decade. Retinal ganglion cell damage occurs at the level of the lamina cribrosa. Yet, we measure the pressure differential across the cornea. So patients with open-angle glaucoma and normal tension glaucoma have lower CSF pressures, whereas patients with ocular hypertension have higher CSF pressures than controls. So the translaminar pressure difference, that is the intraocular pressure minus the cerebrospinal fluid pressure, may actually be a more relevant risk factor than the transcorneal pressure difference. But how can that be measured? Even less likely modifiable is something that we have to still think of. Now, here is a 68-year-old male patient who was diagnosed with normal tension glaucoma, was on a prostaglandin analog. He presented with a disc hemorrhage in the right eye. Perimetry done 4 months later showed a query progression in the defect. Now, this is the fundus picture. Very clearly, you can see the disc hemorrhage. And it took us 4 months to find out that there was progression. So disc hemorrhages are considered a sign of ischemic optic neuropathy in glaucoma. Hemorrhages are located either at the superior or the inferior poles and may be flame-shaped or splinter-shaped. It increases the risk by 3 to 6-fold, indicating the need for more aggressive intraocular pressure reduction, particularly in the older patients with significant normal tension disease. Many studies have linked progression with disc hemorrhages. The CNTG found it to be a major risk factor. And in addition, the disc hemorrhages are also associated with progression in all 3 variants, primary open angle glaucoma, primary angle closure glaucoma, and ocular hypertension. Now, diabetes is also a vascular risk factor as it is a microvasculopathy. Probably it results in non-perfusion and angiogenesis. How it affects glaucoma is controversial. It may lead to vascular damage to the optic nerve head and the retinal ganglion cells, making them more susceptible to damage. It could cause changes in the trabecular meshwork as well. Sleep apnea is something else that we have to learn to look at. Obstructive sleep apnea is a chronic condition leading to apneic periods with hypopneas and respiratory arousals are an emerging risk factor for glaucoma. According to the Wisconsin Sleep Cohort Study, the incidence is from 2 to 4%, known to be associated with systemic hypertension, cardiovascular disease, stroke, and abnormal glucose metabolism. Obstructive sleep apnea is associated with many ocular pathologies. 10% of patients with obstructive sleep apnea have glaucoma, and 50% of normal tension glaucomas have OSA. Also associated with floppy lid, CRVO, worsening of retinopathies, both hypertensive and diabetic, may have papilledema and NAION. Sergey et al. Found that severity of OSA correlated with the intraocular pressure, the mean deviation in a visual field, the cup disc ratio, and the mean thickness of the retinal nerve fiber layer. Metabolic and vascular changes resulting from excess carbon dioxide superimposed on the endothelial damage due to hypoxia, and that is probably responsible for glaucoma. So how do you diagnose a patient with sleep apnea? Normally, the patient is obese. He has a large neck circumference, greater than 40 centimeters, is tired even on waking up, snores during sleep, and wakes up in the middle of his sleep quite often due to respiratory distress. So sleep labs do sleep studies like nocturnal polysomnography and diagnose sleep apnea by the apnea-hypopnea index. If the AIHI or the apnea hypopnea index is greater than 15, then the patient is supposed to have moderate sleep apnea, and anything between 15 and 30 is severe. The treatment is very simple. You just got to refer this patient, obviously, to a physician who will then put him on a CPAP. If there is a local obstruction, then there could be a surgical removal of that airway obstruction. Increased blood viscosity is also a risk factor. It leads to decrease in blood flow and stasis in the capillaries. This in turn leads to hypoxia, commonly seen after an unusually large blood loss, sometimes seen in patients after a CABG. Now, here is a 52-year-old male patient who is diagnosed to have POAG, who started on treatment. He was very regular with treatment. IOPs on medication were well in their teens, but patient's perimetry was seen to be progressing despite this. His blood pressure was normal. He was very compliant. He was not obese. He didn't have any diabetes. He was an athlete. And in the last year, he had started doing yoga. He started doing shirsasan every morning. And on a diurnal, his peak IOP was 28 to 30 millimeters of mercury. So diurnal variations of intraocular pressure have found to be a big risk factor for progression. Astrani et al. Have shown patients with higher fluctuations to progress more rapidly. The AGIS has also proven larger diurnal variation in IOP increases the odds of visual field progression in eyes with a low mean intraocular pressure. This is another case of a 65-year-old female on treatment for POAG, very compliant with therapy, continued to progress despite being on target at every visit. She used to actually use an alarm to use her medications, and her IOPs were always ranging between 14 and 16 millimeters of mercury. But a diurnal showed a peak at 7 a.m. and that was 24 millimeters of mercury. On detailed history, she used to drink large volume of water on getting up. So as we have seen to start with, there are many risk factors that have been actually identified by these various randomized clinical trials. So to conclude, there are many of these above risk factors which just cannot be changed. For instance, you can't change the patient's age or his retrocorneal thickness or his existing visual field damage, or if he has pseudo exfoliation or a disc hemorrhage. None of this can actually be tackled by us. So then what can we alter? We can definitely alter his ocular perfusion pressure. We can look for obstructive sleep apnea and treat it. We can look to see whether there is vasospasm, which is causing progression of his disease. If he's a hypertensive, we need to treat his systemic hypertension correctly and make sure that he is not going into nocturnal hypotension. We need to stabilize his diabetes, and we have to prevent his IOP fluctuations, sometimes by going into very detailed history, by finding out if he has fluid overloads, if he's using breath holding, if he uses certain postures during exercise. So to summarize, various risk factors have been investigated in glaucoma. Every risk factor is complexly linked to each other. IOP-related mechanical stress, BP-related vascular stress, and disturbed autoregulation are complexly linked to each other in the development and progression of open-angle glaucoma. Daily repetitive ischemia reperfusion insults to ocular structures might also play a role in the vascular pathogenesis of NTG. All in all, we've looked at so many risk factors, and there are a few factors other than intraocular pressure, which we can all definitely intervene at different times if you find that your patient with glaucoma is progressing despite being on his target intraocular pressure. With this, I would like to thank all of you and remind you that a nation's culture resides in its heart and the soul of its people. During this crisis that we are facing, I hope all of us, therefore, just stay put, stay home, stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I think that was a wonderful presentation, and you very lucidly explained everything about non-IOP risk factors in the management of glaucoma, which is backed up with studies and with examples. And a person who's not into glaucoma like me also understood everything. So that is the best part of the thing. So there are some questions which we will take. And I would like to ask Dr. Manisha this. Are ocular blood flow measurements by Doppler readily available? And do you really tell people to get Doppler studies done?
problem is the training and for the interpretation, which is not given very widespread, and we are not trained ourselves to do it. So that is where the deficiency lies. So you have to have a person in your locality with, who is well versed with this test, and then it is, the machine is easily available almost everywhere. So that can be arranged. Only the training part and the passing of the information is, that's where the hitch lies many times, but it's not difficult. It can easily be done. As far as whether we are doing, when you have a patient who falls in the category of all the patients which Rita has described, either he is a patient who is normal tension suspect, or who is a patient who is very well controlled on your IOP measurements, but the fields go on progressing and sometimes an unequal progression between the two eyes. And these patients, you have to have a protocol to investigate all the points which Rita pointed out. Broadly speaking and recapitulating what she said is, definitely you need to investigate whether they have got what we call nocturnal hypotension episodes. Second is, you need to know whether they have got sleep apnea kind of thing. The migraine can be very easily deciphered by taking a history. So you don't need any fancy test to do that. Central corneal thickness, which she mentioned, is we are doing in all these kind of patients. So that is not an additional thing which we are, I would say we are anyway doing. Most of the places I'm seeing is nowadays corneal thickness is always done. But after doing all these things, how many of these things can you really change? The nocturnal hypotension, if it is induced by a drug, you can discuss with the cardiologist and shift the timing of the drug and see. Again, the testing for the nocturnal hypotension is to be done by a, what we call a color Doppler. And you have to do it, sorry, by the ambulatory 24 hours Holter monitoring. So Holter monitoring has got two aspects, which is not very well known. You have got Holter monitoring for the ECG, which is to look for arrhythmias. And that also sometimes could be a factor, but not that commonly described with glaucoma. And you have the 24-hour BP test. Now, I have burnt my fingers like this. I've taken a piece of paper and written to the cardiologist, please do Holter monitoring without knowing. And the patient comes back with a 24-hour ECG report, which is of no use to us. So you have to send the patient back and say, now do a 24-hour BP record. So you have to specify 24 hours blood pressure Holter monitoring. And then you get to know that if there are dips, especially in the nighttime. And usually the cardiologist can see that as well. And then you can discuss with the cardiologist and see what can be done.
So it was really interesting to know so many risk factors. I was just wondering, in cases who are having migraine, I mean, do you suggest that these patients should be screened?
As a glaucoma?
Sorry.
Yeah, okay, Rita, go ahead.
No, sorry.
So all patients of migraine do need to have a general eye examination. That is for certain. And we as eye surgeons have to look at every patient with a view of picking up glaucoma, especially the ones who are more so in the ones who are above the age of 40. So that goes without saying that all migraine patients need to have a basic evaluation to see whether there is any chance of glaucoma.
And there's so much of, talk about early morning drinking of water. And earlier, this was the practice that people used to feel that, if you drink a lot of water in the morning, all the systems will be, fine. But now, glaucoma, people don't advocate that. They say that it's not correct. So there's a question Dr. Preeti has asked, that how much volume of water can be safely taken at a time?
See, normally, we recommend to patients who have a positive water drinking response. So basically, everybody doesn't have a positive water drinking response. What is a positive water drinking response is when you take the standard 1 liter of water within a period of around 20 minutes, you start seeing the IOP going up, and the difference between the baseline IOP and the maximum IOP is about 8 millimeters. That's what you would call a positive IOP response to water drinking. Everybody doesn't have it. Even glaucoma patients sometimes don't have it. So you don't know for sure which patient will have. And the second point is that every person who has a positive IOP response to water drinking need not develop glaucoma. So there are a lot of deficiencies over here. Now, the question is, how much water can you advocate safely? Very frankly speaking, there has been no such study done. So I cannot answer with the backup of science. But we always answer with the backup of common sense. We tell patients that you can have, you know, about say 100, 200 ml at a time and then give a gap of around 15, 20 minutes before you take some more. This is what I advise. There is no scientific basis for the advice that I am giving. And that is the disclaimer.
Any reason for specifying that, you know, early morning water drinking is not very good?
No, it's not. It's not just early morning. It is any time water drinking. But as you mentioned, you know, in yoga, this is a known practice, and that is why this early morning time has come in.
Yeah.
There's another question related to yoga, and it says that what are the maneuvers in yoga which should be avoided by patients who have glaucoma?
So generally, we advise patients who have glaucoma to avoid the head down positions like Shirsasan and Sarvangasan kind of things where your feet go completely up and your head remains completely down. Second thing is when you do pranayama, you do sometimes very severe Valsalva kind of procedures which can worsen angle closure kind of scenarios. So you can let them do it, but tell them to do it less vigorously. These are the normal advice.
Dr. Muscati says he has ocular sleep apnea, but he is not obese. So does he have any chance of having a normal tension glaucoma?
Now, if you are having sleep apnea and not doing what is to be told, what is going to happen is you may develop mental dementia, which also is a possibility. There are so many things that can develop besides glaucoma.
Many things that can happen. You can get a stroke.
You can get a stroke.
You can have so many things.
I'm sure he'll get scared after listening to all this. Then Dr. K.B. Bhargav wants to know when to start AGT, anti-glaucoma treatment, for these cases. Yeah. Do you in your practice, I mean, it was just out of curiosity that I'm asking you, do you in your practice pick up these cases incidentally, normal tension glaucoma?
Normal tension glaucoma is different from the scenario which Rita has accurately described. But normal tension glaucoma is a diagnosis of exclusion. So and essentially...
What would you call this?
So because these are additional risk factors playing a role in normal angle closure or open angle patients.
Okay.
So normally when we see a patient of glaucoma, you have a protocol of investigations doing these tests. And then if you find a raise, means you are going to treat the patient based on whether it is mild, moderate, severe, target pressure calculation, and then you are going to initiate the treatment. The most important part of glaucoma treatment is not the medication, is not the surgery, but monitoring. So watching what is happening in the patient is the most important treatment that you're giving the patient, because glaucoma is very varied. On one extreme, you have patients who have very clearly raised pressure, a disc change and a perimetry change. And for 10 years, nothing happens, even though you don't do anything to reduce their pressure. And you have another extreme like Rita showed, where you do everything and you bring the pressure in the very close range of 14 to 16 and still you see progression. So first you have to watch what is happening. And once you see that this patient is progressing, then you have to start doing, if every patient of glaucoma I write down, do perimetry, do OCT, we'll do gonioscopy, then you go and do your 24-hour Holter monitoring, then you go and do sleep apnea study, you do a 2D echo, you are going to have too many investigations, then, you know, half of these are not needed in all patients. So it's better to be judicious and advise these investigations and start looking for these things when you find the evidence. And that is only to be got when you repeatedly check up the patient and see that there is progression and changes are not going the way you would expect with your treatment based on target pressure.
Can I come in for a minute? Namrata, I think you had said that, do these patients really walk into us and do we just incidentally see them? Unfortunately, both Manish and I are at tertiary care centers, and therefore more often than not, you know, some other ophthalmologist has seen something wrong with the disc. He becomes a disc suspect, but the pressures are normal and, you know, they're very worried, and that is when they actually come to us. That is how we more commonly see NTGs.
Correct.
Though everything else that Manish said is absolutely right.
Then again, in the same direction like yoga and drinking water, there's another question that whether breath holding exercises should be avoided in glaucoma patients.
Yes, they should.
Anything related to breath holding?
Yeah, so there are musicians, for instance, who play these instruments, where they've been blowing instruments, where they hold their breath for a long time. These patients are known to progress if they have glaucoma. So definitely these are the people whom we will say, don't do your breath holding. Similarly, like Manish said, when you have patients who are doing pranayama in a very... at a very advanced level where they hold their breath for a long time. Sometimes these are the patients who also are known to progress. So surely you have to tell them not to use these breath holding exercises.
There are a couple of questions on diurnal variation and diurnal variation measurements and diurnal fluctuations. So what is the method and what should be the gap? So what is your standard method of doing it?
So, unfortunately for me, as against most general practitioners, because we have residents, we can get our patients admitted and have a full diurnal done. But in practice, this is really logistically not possible. And so now they do what is known as an office time diurnal. So they ask the patients to come in at different times, once in the morning, once in the afternoon, once in the evening, and they check out the pressures and they look at the kind of variation. Sometimes they also keep the patient from morning to evening in the clinic itself and keep measuring their pressures every 2 hours. And so you get an adequate response to see whether there is a good amount of variation in their pressures from the morning to the evening. Though I personally think that it would be the most correct thing to have your patient admitted, because usually you see that the rises in pressure are early morning. So, you know, immediately on waking up. Also, the change in posture from lying down to getting up, that itself also induces a change in the intraocular pressure.
And any connection between alcohol intake and intraocular pressure, as many patients ask this question?
Manish?
Actually, alcohol immediately reduces intraocular pressure. So if you are on a flight and a patient develops acute angle closure glaucoma, what is the treatment you can give the patient? Is give him neat whiskeys to drink. And that can reduce the intraocular pressure. This is actually a fact. But once the effect of alcohol goes up, you get a rebound spike. So alcohol intake and definitely the fluid intake along with the alcohol also is important. So if you are taking kind of beer or you know, alcohol which has a lot of fluid, then it can have the effect of excessive fluid intake too. So less diluted alcohol or more concentrated alcohol is known to reduce intraocular pressure. Now, whether the patient should be allowed to take a dripeg or two or not is an open question. Well, usually I do allow them, or I do say that it's okay to have a little social drink, but definitely anything in excess is to be very strictly avoided. And anything which will lead to a lot of fluid intake to be had is also to be avoided.
So basically the dehydrating effect of the alcohol. Then there are questions that if there are disc hemorrhages, whether we should put the patient on. The basic idea is that when do you start the anti-glaucoma treatment? That's what the question means. That when do you consider starting an anti-glaucoma medication, whether you wait for the field changes to happen or there are certain features on which, on the basis of which you start?
See, this is a very good question. The first thing is that you are not going to be able to stop the patient from really progressing. All you are actually doing is slowing the rate of progression down by your treatment. And your treatment should be aimed at the risk of vision loss that the patient has. So for example, if you see a patient with a disc hemorrhage, as has been asked, and of course you will do all the tests. So if you find a narrow angle that is out of question, you are definitely going to do a YAG iridotomy and follow up the patient as an angle closure patient. But say you find nothing, fields are normal, OCT is normal, even your clinical examination of the disc. Usually when you are having the acute hemorrhage, you may not be able to evaluate the disc very accurately. So you can wait for a couple of months, say about 6 weeks, let that hemorrhage completely clear and then do the disc evaluation and OCT also at that time. You don't do the OCT when the hemorrhage is there. But once you do all this, maybe on an OCT, you might find a nerve fiber layer defect or some amount of thinning. But say perimetry is normal, an IOP is normal, diurnal variation is normal, corneal thickness is normal, angle is open. Would I start a patient on treatment just because I saw the disc hemorrhage appear and disappear? That's not true, because disc hemorrhages can appear due to many reasons. But definitely, most certainly, I'll put the patient on a regular follow-up schedule. That is the most important step. But if you find anything else, like if you find a disc hemorrhage along with a field defect, and especially a field defect which is close to fixation, coming close to the area of fixation, then your intent to treat or your need to treat definitely goes to the next step. So your treatment is going to be based on the risk of this patient developing serious vision problems due to glaucoma. And just because you got a suspect of glaucoma, that means you must treat is a wrong association.
Once you have a suspect for glaucoma, the first thing you need to do is put the patient on a follow-up schedule.
So are there any prospects of getting an objective visual field analysis like a multifocal VEP testing in the near future?
The multifocal ERG has been tested for glaucoma, and there have been reports of comparing that with visual fields, and some of them are encouraging, but over a long period of time, they have not been able to really translate that into clinical use today. So somehow there is still something defective or something needed in improvement of technology before this can be applicable. And once it becomes applicable, we will be much better off in treating glaucoma for sure.
Then I think there is a question by Dr. Sneha. If in admitted patients, how frequently the IOP should be measured? Do you, for a diurnal variation, do you ask the patient to come at particular time points or do you admit the patient and do it? I think, like, for instance, in
as Rita mentioned, Rita mentioned, and all the teaching institutes which have admitted facility and residents who have nothing else to do but to take IOP pressures, you can admit the patient, make them do it, and do it every hourly. We did that as residents for, and sometimes even in the night, we used to do every 3 hourly at night also. So we have done all that as residents, and we used to those times use a Schiot sphenometer, of course, in the on the bedside of the patient. But now, obviously, you would use a Perkins or you would do a slit lamp tonometry. So if you have facility to admit the patient, then that's what you would do. What I do in my practice is I take all the patients at different times in the day. The first time I call is, sometimes I call at 8 o'clock because that's when I open my clinic. I know that there is a peak in the morning. But the thing is, you want to know what is happening over time. So 8 o'clock, I once called the patient. The second time I sometimes call the patient is around 11 or 12 o'clock. The third time I call is between 4 and 5. And the fourth time I call is at 8 in the night. So you have a 24-hour stretch and you can see the patient four times. The problem is where the patient lives. If the patient lives in the vicinity of my clinic and works in the vicinity of my clinic, I give him a choice that he can do all the four visits on one day or come on different times. But definitely if the patient is staying far away, then I let them remain in my clinic for the whole day and do the tests in that manner.
Dr. Sheetal wants to know that hypertension reduces ocular perfusion pressure and causes glaucoma progression. How does hypertension can affect glaucoma and what level of BP is acceptable?
Rita, you need to unmute yourself.
Systemic hypertension is related to ocular perfusion pressure, and it's a very complex kind of a mechanism. There is no but the diastolic perfusion pressure, if that is more than 50 mercury, then you know that that is definitely going to affect ocular perfusion pressure, and therefore you will try to see that that is lesser than that. So the diastolic perfusion pressure is calculated, like I told you, I had given you the formula, 2/3 of the pressure minus the intraocular pressure.
And what type of antihypertensive drug cause nocturnal hypotension?
Not like the anti-glaucoma medication, but it is the systemic.
Antihypertensive, systemic, I think that is what they are.
So, yeah, we know that beta blockers, for instance, do give rise to nocturnal hypotension. So we normally talk to the physician concerned. We also, once we have handed over the patient to the physician to find out for his Holter BP monitoring, if they can identify what is the medication that is best suited to the patient and the best time at which it can be dosed so that you can avoid the nocturnal hypertension, then that is what we actually look for.
And there's one more question regarding that only, that if the patient is taking beta blocker, for control of systemic hypertension. So, which anti-glaucoma medication will you give? Will you give beta blocker or you will not give beta blocker?
Obviously, the patient is already taking a systemic beta blocker. Then if you give him a topical beta blocker, it's not going to act. So, you would definitely not give him a topical beta blocker. There are so many other medications that are available. Our first line of treatment, especially at present, is, of course, the prostaglandin analog.
Okay. And what level of BP is really acceptable? Because hypotension would cause reduction in the ocular perfusion pressure and cause progression of glaucoma. So what would you be the say? I mean, what would be the acceptable BP range, blood pressure range for these patients?
So if the pressure is not too high, because the whole thing, you know, if you have a high pressure and if you have a low pressure and if you have a high intraocular pressure, then your ocular perfusion pressure decreases. If you have a high blood pressure and if you have a high intraocular pressure, whenever your systemic blood pressure increases, obviously you're going to have a lower ocular perfusion pressure. So there's no fixed level, and you have to actually calculate. Look, you don't really go and do ocular perfusion pressure for every patient who has glaucoma. It's only these particular category of patients whom you realize are not responding to the normal line of treatment. It is these people whom we actually look forth to. Manish, do you have anything
to add? It's very simple. Simply at all, you know, like if you see the normal blood pressure readings which you yourself are taking or getting it taken from somebody in your normal OT set, if you see, most of the times the systolic pressure is the one which is going up and down. The diastolic more or less is some between 70 and 90. Sometimes you find higher diastolic pressure, but averagely it is there. So if you do the calculation, the importance is the diastolic ocular perfusion pressure. So you take 70 and you take and minus and 2/3 of that and you minus the IOP from there. So even if you don't do 2/3, just remember from 70, if you minus 20, you're going to get 50, and that is the danger range. So if the patient has got a high intraocular pressure about say 25, from 50, if you minus 25 or 70, you minus 25, then you are definitely landing up below 50, and that is a red mark for you. So when I take history of the patient, normal history, I don't go and do the Holter for everybody, but you can ask the patient, do you know what your blood pressure is usually when you go to your physician? No, it's very well controlled. They'll never come out with the figure. So you have to tell them when you come back again to me, whenever you follow up, you just bring your 2-3 BP readings. This is what I tell them, and what I see is the diastolic pressure. And 70 is my mental cutoff. If I see any patient telling me that his pressure is going below 70, or even below, say, 75, then I say that this guy will probably need to monitor his 24-hour BP Holter. Or otherwise, if the keeps on progressing despite his pressures remaining very well controlled.
And there's a question by Dr. Purushottam who wants to know that how do you calculate the target IOP in NTGs and POAGs? There are many people who are interested in knowing the target pressure, what should be.
So, the whole thing over here, I would like to make it very simple, because only simple things you remember in life, complicated formulas, at least I don't have the intelligence to remember them when I'm seeing big heavy OPD. So, it is like this, you first have to evaluate the level of damage and you have to know what type of glaucoma you are treating. In an open angle glaucoma means you see whether the patient's damage level is mild, moderate or severe, and whether the visual field defect is threatening or in within the central 10 degrees or not. These two factors you have to keep in mind. Based on that, you have to start deciding your target pressure. Whatever the pre-treatment pressure is, my target pressure for mild glaucomas would be somewhere in the higher teens or in the around 17, 18. And for moderate glaucomas, it will be between 14, 16, 17. And for severe glaucomas, it will be lower than 14 or 14 max. Obviously, all this has to be corrected for corneal thickness and all that. But this is the baseline. And this one thing, if you sit in your head, you won't have a problem. You have to modify this patient to patient depending on whether you see progression or whether you see threat to fixation or if you see that there are too many fluctuations. All these are additional points, but just fixing a basic target pressure, this is enough. Coming to NTG, the whole formula is different. In NTG, because the pre-treatment pressure itself is below 21, so how do you gather where to go? So the basic thing is, if it is a very severe damage where you have a tunnel vision and only very bad diagnosis, then you would aim for 30-35% reduction from baseline. You said it is below 21. So either it will be in the range, in the higher teen range, or it is in the mid-teen range. Based on that, if you calculate 30%, 30% is 1/3. So you take the pressure, say if it was say 18, 18s are 30% means you want to reduce it by around 6. So it has to come in the 12 range. this is the, and if you can't consider that it is not a very advanced glaucoma and you want to reduce it, then take it or reduce it by 20%. So in that case, you would reduce it by 4, in which case 14 would be also good enough. So this is the broad way you go about in normal tension glaucoma.
Another thing that I would like to actually say is that, you know, the lower the pressure, the more difficult it is to bring the pressure down. So in normal tension glaucomas, you know, their pressures are always under 20. So bringing their pressure from 20 to anything lower than that is like the most difficult task. If you say that prostaglandins normally bring down the pressure by 30%, you won't see that happen in a normal tension glaucoma. However, having said that, in severe tension glaucomas who are progressing, I would always aim to keep my target pressure at episcleral venous pressure.
Okay. What about the drugs that improve the perfusion? Like we have been discussing about brimonidine and some other drugs as well. So, what's the role of these drugs?
So we know, and lots of people have been talking about neuroprotection on a very, very big level. Mm-hmm. And there are so many drug trials that have, you know, been done to look at neuroprotection, but we have actually yet to identify a single drug which is really, really useful in glaucoma. So there has been the Logit study in which they used brimonidine versus timolol to see if the reduction in pressure or the normalcy of the visual fields was probably better when they used brimonidine than when they used timolol. However, having said that, we don't have, you know, real proof to say that brimonidine is neuroprotective. In addition to that, there is also the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, which claims to be a vasodilator and hence increases the perfusion. And so they also claim that it could be a neuroprotective. There are plenty of claims made by the ROCK inhibitors now, which claim to say that they also activate or enhance the healing process of the retinal ganglion cells. But none of these have been clinically or, you know, regimentally proved to be good neuroprotectors. So I think as of now, reducing the intraocular pressure seems to be the only neuroprotectant that seems to work.
A lot of commercial angle these days is on ROCK inhibitors, as you mentioned.
I agree.
And a lot of companies are promoting ROCK inhibitors.
That's true.
So still they are in the, you can say that we are not very sure about their actual role. And
they do tell us that it works in three ways. And one of them is to enhance the cell regeneration. And therefore, they claim that it could be very good to enhance the RGC protection. So I don't know, but it hasn't yet been proven. There's been no randomized clinical trial which said that, yes, it is definitely a neuroprotectant.
So what would be the practical measure of RGC protection? I mean, only when it translates into your visual fields and there's no interim measure by which you can, some objective method to measure RGC protection apart from when, you know, it has converted into its effect that visual field loss is there or disc hemorrhage is there?
Yeah, so I think that is something that we are looking at. Probably, you know, we have to still progress a lot in terms of technology, because until we can actually identify individual retinal ganglion cells by some mode very easily, just now what they're doing is all in the lab, but unless we are able to identify individual retinal ganglion cells very easily clinically, it is not possible. The other thing that we do is we can look at the retinal nerve fiber layer thickness. But these are, you can actually measure your corneal cells, and therefore you're very happy with ROCK inhibitors.
And measure your corneal cells. You can see them on, confocal microscopy. You have all the surrogate. I mean, things which are, much more objective as compared to glaucoma.
So true. I agree. So maybe if you are able to prove it in cornea, then there'll be something else that will take us towards glaucoma.
So what do you do when
the IOP?
Rajesh, continue, Rajesh.
Yeah, she was mentioning about episcleral venous pressure. So Dr. Preeti wants to know how do you know episcleral venous pressure?
Well, it's a well-known fact that episcleral venous pressure is somewhere around 10 or 11 millimeters of mercury, so generally. And that is where we aim to get to.
Uh, then people have asked multiple times, how do you decide the target pressure? How do you decide the target pressure in NTG, in this kind of damage and otherwise also? So if you have to look at various kinds of glaucoma, how do you decide your target pressure?
Yeah, so there's a very, Manish gave you a very simple clinical method of how to go to the target pressure. But otherwise, there are some factors that you look at. You look at the age of the patient. You look at the amount of damage that is present when the patient comes to you. You look at the pressure that the patient comes to you with. You look at if he's been coming to you repeatedly, you look at his rate of progression, and you look at his central corneal thickness. Obviously, younger the patient and more the damage, you will want his target pressure to be very, very less. Older the patient, even if he has a very severe damage, you're not going to be very aggressive about treatment because he has very few years, you know, of vision futility to be used over a very small period of time. Whereas if you see a patient who's like 40 years, and if you're looking at him living up to 80, you have to preserve his vision for the next 40 years. So you're going to be really aggressive with that kind of a patient. If you have a very early damage, your target pressure will be much lesser than if you have a very advanced damage, because there's very little retinal ganglion cells left to preserve. And what we are trying to do is only trying to preserve whatever vision there is. We're not going to be able to give him additional vision anyways. Now, if you find that you have a fast progressor, if the rate of progression is really rapid, then you'll want to keep the pressure much lower than if you see that the rate of progression is very stable and slow. Also, patients who've got thin central corneas, that people with thin central corneal thicknesses are going to progress much rapidly as compared to people with thicker corneas, and that has been proven now by the OAT study. So if you see a patient who's got a thin cornea, who's got even not a moderate disease, not a very severe disease, you'll definitely want to bring his pressure down to much lesser than normal. Though
there is
so many pressure, millimeters of mercury in terms of intraocular pressure.
Okay.
So suppose there's a patient who has a normal tension glaucoma, or I mean the pressures are say 10 to 11 millimeters range, and the disc shows signs of progression. So when do you decide, when would you operate on these kind of patients? The pressures are quite okay, say between the range of say 10, 12, it should be your target pressure. And how do you then decide when do you have to operate them?
Okay, now if you've got a patient who's already come to episcleral venous pressure, there's nothing, I mean, lowering the pressure anymore is not going to help him with his glaucoma. Obviously, at this point in time, it is a non-IOP risk factor which has to be investigated. So this is the patient where a non-IOP risk factor has to be definitely looked into. So you must see whether he has adequate perfusion happening. You must see whether he's got fluctuations in his intraocular pressure. So when you're taking it, it is 10 or 11, but there may be different times, different pressures happening. You have to look into the compliance of this patient. You have to find out whether this patient is at sometimes, you know, holding his breath for a long time for whatever reason, whether he is using large fluid overloads at some point in time, whether he has sleep apnea. These and other things you have to take into account when you see a patient at pressures of 10 or 12 and continuing to progress. Because lowering intraocular pressure more than that is definitely not going to help this patient's glaucoma.
And these are unmodifiable factors, you know, like, I mean, how do you test for them and then how do you monitor them? So would you, in how much percentage of your patients in such cases that you talked about today, you would do surgery, trabeculectomy, for instance? Or would you do
pressures, if their pressures are where they need to be, and that is something that I would say to myself, I will definitely not opt for a surgery because I know that their pressures are already where they are. So what am I going to achieve by doing a trabeculectomy? I'm not going to achieve anything more. So I have to talk to the patient. And then maybe I have to, you know, make him understand, okay, he's got to live with what he has. And we'll try to modify his lifestyle. We'll try to help him reason out. And, you know, of course, give him hope, but maybe get more opinions. See if I have missed something and somebody else can help me get to where I need to. And there are many times when Manish and I keep, I keep sending my patients across to find out that, am I doing the right thing? Have I missed something? And I only tell him, please look at this patient as a new patient. Don't even ask. I'm not even going to give you any history. So that he is not biased because of what I have said. So I think these are ways in which you can deal with such patients.
Dr. Manish, what about surgeries?
The same point I would like to add is that, nothing is there, as we discuss on these kind of conferences, the real things are very different. The moment you tell the patient that I have given you all the drugs I can give you and still you are progressing and I don't know the reason, we'll do other tests, he's going to get another opinion. And moment he goes to another person, he's going to come back with a new pressure. When we have measured all the pressures are between 10, 12 and 13, he'll say, doctor, udhar dikhaya na, udhar to 18 aaya. So the things are not like that in real world, and it becomes very difficult for us to, because patient is losing vision. So it is a matter of concern for us also. And to convince them to go for all these tests, and very often they go to the cardiologist tells them, ye sab ka zarurat hi nahi hai, kya hai, aapko blood pressure hai, dawai nahi lega to stroke aayega aapko, again he'll come back to you. And so it is really very difficult in the real world to manage these patients. And it is case to case basis on which we have to manage and take decisions.
So there's one scenario
you
which...
spend a lot of chair time with your patient actually in such situations. The more chair time you spend, the more confidence your patient develops in you, the better rapport you develop with your patient. All that is going to help maximally.
So there's this situation which has been given. A young male, 23-year-old, presenting with IOP in 30s and advanced disc changes. So how do you manage? I think this is not a case scenario of the scenario that we have discussed, but if you have a patient, a very young patient with IOP in 30s, so and with progression of disc changes, so what would be, or would you go in for surgery in these cases?
Just because he's...
You have to unmute yourself.
Unmute. I think, admin, yeah. Can you please unmute? Yes.
Yeah, I'm unmuted. Yes. So it's not necessary that a young patient who's 23 years old and who's come with a large, with an advanced disease, so-called into inverted commas, necessarily needs to undergo a surgery. You can always still look at him, work him up completely, and you can give him a trial of drugs. Because you said 30, but you haven't told us whether this patient is on medication or otherwise. If the patient is already on medication, then of course we would think of surgery. Or we would probably think of another drug and see whether we can bring him down and then think about surgery. But surgery is not like a no-no. But that is like not the first thing. You don't have to jump because the pressure is 30. I have to operate you immediately. That is not the way we look at patients. Manish, do you have something else to say?
23-year-old patient coming with pressures of 30. As to add on to what you have already said, I don't want to repeat. Mm-hmm. History of steroid use is very, very, very important. Corneal thickness is very, very important. And then you apply the rules which we discussed right now, is that this is a patient who is young, who has his whole life to go, and with pressures of 30 and a very compromised field, you would definitely categorize this patient as one in which you are going to be aggressive. So what does aggressive treatment mean? Aggressive treatment means, number one, maximum pressure reduction. So definitely you are going to bring this patient needs pressures to come down at least to 15, 16. So that if you see that it is not nearly 50%, but minimum that much reduction of pressure you will target. Number two, you will want a steady pressure control throughout the day. So once you put the patient on treatment, you are going to do what we call a diurnal while on treatment. Second, third thing is that you would want more tests. So you would repeat visual fields more frequently. And if the very peripheral fields are already damaged, you will do more of 10-2 tests to know what's going on with the patient. And then after that, if after doing all this, you still find patient to be not maintaining good pressures, or like you have decided you want at least minimum 15 pressure and the patient's pressure is remaining 18, 20, despite putting 3-3-4-4 drugs, let me tell you, younger the patient, the more difficult they find to put more drops because they have so many things to do in the whole day. Then you would probably think of a intervention to bring the surgical intervention probably to bring the patient.
And in one night patients with 0.8 cupping, when do you decide to go for surgery? I think this is again a general question, not specifically related to it, but it will be good if you both can take that. One night patient with 0.8 cupping. When do you decide to go for
surgery? 0.8 doesn't tell me anything, because 0.8 could be a normal, in a large disc, 0.8 could be normal. But let me take the question in the way it has been put. It's a one-eyed patient with an advanced glaucoma. Say already he has got a bioaccretive defect, and already in 10-2 also there is encroachment. That's what the person who's putting the question really wants to say. Let me tell you that a patient who has got advanced glaucoma with bioaccretive defect with encroachment and 10-2 also will not have a 0.8. Usually they will have only a small sliver of neural rim remaining in the nasal part of the optic disc. So this is the very advanced glaucoma. Now, very important, as Rita mentioned, is what is the age of the patient, number one. Number two is what is the life expectancy of the patient. Say the patient is 70 years old, but he already has cancer. So you know that this maximum life expectancy you can put is another 5 years, not more than that. So you have to target your treatment according to that. Or a patient who is 70 years old and has got pulmonary fibrosis, which is very common these days. So these kind of things have to be, comorbidities have to be looked into, not only from the point of view of what treatment to start, but to be how aggressive. But when do you decide to operate? Definitely, as I said, this is a patient in whom you will have to be very careful regarding monitoring. So monitoring, you can only get a decision-making change, because even progression, you cannot decide progression just on one piece. You are going to need progression, reconfirmation, and then confirmation. So you are going to need minimum 3 fields to be done on the same machine in a repeatable manner before you can say that this patient has progressed. And if you get a change, say once in the superior quadrant and the second time you got in the inferior quadrant, where you saw the change in the first test has again become normal, that is also not a convincing change. So you have to get a repeatable change in the same area and reconfirm that before you take a decision on progression. So you have to do a lot of testing. So you have to convince this patient that you will need much more visual field testing. And let me tell you, in these patients, OCT is more or less useless. In my practice, I don't really, there are a lot of studies coming out is that now you look at the macula and advanced disease and all. I have done all that in my practice, and I have really not been able to convince myself that it is worth it. So you have to depend on perimetry, 10-2 perimetry only, to take decisions in these patients usually.
You mentioned about OCT. Is there a role of OCTA in glaucoma?
OCTA is under active investigation, and that's it.
Yeah.
It's not giving us any guidelines or parameters as of now.
Okay. There's one question that, when do you start treatment in ocular hypertension? This is again a general question.
So Rita is again muted. So for some reason, I only have to answer.
Can admin please? Yes.
Yeah, yes. Now Rita can answer.
So we can't hear.
She's still muted, so I guess you have only applied.
Yeah, so ocular hypertension, fortunately, is a condition which has been studied in a randomized control fashion, and guidelines have been given. So ocular hypertension needs to be treated only when you have a risk factor. So the risk factor, as well as far as intraocular pressure is concerned, any intraocular pressure which is about 27, 28, you would definitely treat, even if everything is normal. Besides that, if you have a patient who has got a thin cornea, then you would treat. And if you see something which is a suspicious change on the optic disc, or you see a little higher pattern standard deviation on your visual field, then you would, because these are suspicious that they've already started changing. These are the patients whom you would initiate treatment. If the patient's pressure is well, about 25, 24, and nothing's shown, on the corneal thickness is normal, or it is on the higher side, then these are the patients whom you can happily observe. Because the progression rates in the ocular hypertension treatment study has been quite low, and that is progression to develop the first visual field defect. Those visual field defects are not visually significant. So you have a big scope of observation in ocular hypertension, and most of the patients we are advising observation.
Okay.
What is your opinion?
I want
to ask both of you this. What is your opinion on that portable visual field analyzer, which, you know, people can just wear like that, and, you know, the fields can be analyzed?
It's very exciting. But as of now, my personal, whatever time I tested it myself and whatever time I've seen my colleagues report is that it definitely is very easy to do. So that is a very big plus point and patients love it is the plus point. The negative points are that as yet it is still far from standardization. Even forget progression, even standardizing the defects or the picking up existing defects itself, the false negative rate is also there. Besides the false positive rate, there is a false negative rate. So it fails to pick up known visual field defects which are already seen on your standard perimetry. Sometimes are completely missed by this technique. And that seems to be quite a challenging step just now. So I don't think it has still reached a stage when we can even advocate screening by using those techniques.
So we had the advantage of doing 100 patients with one of these kind of perimetries in the last year. And we found that our patients were extremely happy because we had a head-on-head comparison. So we put them through both the perimetries unequally. Sometimes this first, depending upon which machine was available at that point in time. But they did this consecutively. So on the same day, they did this test and the other test. And we found that they were extremely happy with the other variety as compared to our standard perimetry. Of course, because it took much lesser time, we had done a correlation between the visual field defects seen on both, and we seem to have found a pretty good correlation, but standardization still needs to be done because the sample size that we used was not like very big. And I think they are doing a study at multiple centers now, and then they'll probably formulate a better controlled trial wherein we may be able to come out and standardize the use of that perimeter. But I don't think that we can go right out and say you can use it in your glaucoma practice, but it is a good instrument for screening because it's a very short test. You know, the patient doesn't get tired, and you can train your optometrist to get that done, the test done, and it gets done very, very fast.
Okay, there are a lot of questions, and Rajesh, would you take the next one?
Yeah. There's one question from Dr. Raviti. She wants to know, how does antidepressant drugs have a role in young peer education? Any role of antidepressant drugs in young POAG patient?
In fact, antidepressant drugs are known to be contraindicated in POAG. A lot of them are. In angle closure patients, they are contraindicated. And I have not seen any reports of any antidepressant drug having a beneficial effect on the glaucoma. So I think maybe the question is intended a little differently. Rita, so do you have any?
Yeah, I think that, you know, the thing that we have to look for is especially in angle closure, when they're, if they're prone to angle closure, if they're already primary angle closure suspects, then there is a high chance that they can go into an acute angle closure attack. But I have no knowledge of use of antidepressants in patients with primary open angle glaucoma or angle closure glaucoma giving any beneficial effects to the disease per se.
So there is a comment regarding this, that means that if you have a pressure of say 10 to 11, whether it is NTG or POAG or PACG, it's adequate. Would you say that?
It's treated pressure.
Yes. Treated pressure, yeah.
If the patients are on treatment, would your target IOP for all kinds of glaucoma be, say, somewhere between 10 and 11?
That is where you can get. You can't get lower than that.
First of all, you can't even get 10 and 11 on all patients.
That's true.
Do a full thickness filtering procedure, even then you may not get 10 to 11 in all patients. So that is one thing, and is that it is not achievable.
If you get hypotony, then there'll be more problems with looking at the hypotony later.
And what is the drug of choice for such kinds of glaucoma during pregnancy?
Manish, you want to take that?
Drug no, pregnancy? Pregnancy, I think you only did. It's better.
Okay. So there are different classes of drugs We have no class A drugs in ophthalmology whatsoever. We have only class B and class C. The drug that we would definitely avoid in pregnancy is probably prostaglandins, because there is a known factor that the prostaglandins are supposed to cause increased uterine contractions. So in the first trimester and in the last trimester, both, I think I would not want to use prostaglandins at all. You can use beta blockers in the early part of the pregnancy, but towards the later half of the pregnancy, you would be a little scared, because you don't want to induce any respiratory depression in the fetus. And the safest drug to use, therefore, is a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, unless the patient is allergic to sulfur or whatever. And fortunately, the pressure in pregnancy, the intraocular pressure in pregnancy on its own comes down. So my take is actually that if a patient intends to be pregnant or intends to conceive at some point in time, I would be very happy to do an SLT for such a patient, get the pressure down to where it has to be, let her finish her family in that intervening period until the effect of the SLT lasts, so that I don't have to worry about drugs or teratogenicity or anything, and then think about what to do after the family is complete.
So someone has to unmute Dr. Namrata. She's
speaking. Sorry. So somebody wants to know of a scenario whether we should operate on a patient who is PL negative with intraocular pressure of 30 after maximal medication in one eye, with early cataract and other eye pseudophakia counting fingers at 1 meter, with advanced disc changes, and the patient is 65-year-old. So would you recommend that we can go ahead and operate? And I don't see, I mean, of course, you would be better in a position to answer that. But a patient who's PL negative and IOP of 30, do you think you would still operate for a glaucoma surgery? Not getting controlled? No.
Not to bring the pressure down or to giving the patient any vision. But if the patient is unhappy with that pressure, has pain or whatever, then maybe you can do a cyclodestructive procedure and bring the pressure down just to keep the patient happy pain-wise. But I'm sure that we are never going to think of operating on this patient to bring the pressure down for any other reason.
Okay, so we come to the end of this webinar. I'm so thankful to you. It was a fantastic presentation, and both Dr. Rita and Dr. Manish for being and for answering so many questions. I mean, there were so many queries on the Facebook, on the admin where the people log in. And you answered all of them, and I'm sure people would have benefited by these answers, because there are so many times when you do have queries and you don't know whom to ask, and sometimes those queries appear, you know, not so, they are not very great queries, but you just think that simply if you have to ask, where do you ask? So thank you so much, both of you, for being with us today, for sparing your time. Thank you for a great presentation, ma'am. It was really wonderful. It covered everything. Thank you, Manish. Thank you for being there. And I can't see Rajesh. I don't know. Can admin get him back onto the onto our screens? I don't see him here. So thank you so much, ma'am, once again. And thank you, Manish. And I would also like to thank Cipla and all the viewers who viewed this presentation and who made it so live and so interactive. Thank you once again. And thank you, Cipla, for doing this like you do all the other webinars for an educational activity, which is done unconditionally, and we don't even discuss their brand in it. So thank you, everyone, and see you again. So be safe, be healthy, stay at home, and keep watching. Thank you,
ma'am. Thank you.
Sharing your time, and you're so busy doing so many things. I wonder how you manage doing all of those things. But stay safe.
Thank you.
For accepting. Right.
Yeah. Thanks, Rita. Always a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you.